गुड मॉर्निंग क्लास, वेलकम टू द सेकेंड क्लास ऑन द एनाटॉमी ऑफ द आई. नाउ द आई बॉल स्ट्रक्चर्स कैन बी सब डिवाइडेड इनटू द फाइब्रस ट्यूनिक, द वास्कुलर ट्यूनिक एंड द नर्वस ट्यूनिक, दैट इज द रेटिना. सो व्हाट कंस्टिट्यूट द फाइब्रस ट्यूनिक ऑफ द आई? सो द फाइब्रस ट्यूनिक इज द आउटर मोस्ट लेयर ऑफ द आई एंड इट इज कंपोज्ड ऑफ स्क्लेरा विच इज द ओपेक वाइट पार्ट एंड द कॉर्निया विच इज द ट्रांसपेरेंट पार्ट प्लेस्ड एंटीरियरली. So the cornea is one of the most important structures of the eye because it is the main refractive media of the eye, contributing about 40 diopter of refractive power of the eye. So it's a dome-shaped, transparent and non-vascularized layer and it forms the outer covering of the eye. And it is composed of highly organized cells and collagen fibers, and to ensure correct refraction of light it should always remain transparent. And apart from being a refractive media, it also serves as a shield against bacteria, dust and other harmful materials. Now these are the dimensions that you have to remember. Firstly, its anterior surface is elliptical in shape and its horizontal diameter is greater than the vertical diameter. And the average horizontal diameter is 11.75 mm while vertical is 11 mm. And thickness, it is thinnest at the center and it measures about 0.52 millimeter and it is thicker in the periphery, measuring about 0.67 millimeter. The radius of curvature, the anterior one is 7.8 while the posterior is 6.5. Now these are the layers of cornea. This is very important and is given in exams. Firstly, from outside in the layers are, first is the epithelial layer, then is the Bowman's layer, the stroma, the Descemet's membrane and the endothelium. Now the epithelial layer is composed of 5 to 7 layers of cells, the uppermost cell being the squamous cell layer, which have microvilli that absorbs the tear and help keeping the epithelial cells hydrated. Next comes the layer of umbrella shaped cells or wing cells, which are connected to each other via desmosomes, which provide communicating channels. And the innermost layer is called the basal layer, which also forms the limbal stem cell layer. And they are called stem cells because they can multiply and replenish the other cells which have got depleted or damaged. And they are also important because they prevent the encroachment of conjunctival cells onto the cornea. And thus, in case of damage to the basal cell layer, a condition known as pterygium occurs. Now, this is the diagram that you have to memorize and is to be written in the exams. Now the thing to be noted here is that the epithelial cells are permeable to oxygen and nutrition via lacrimation. So the source of oxygen and nutrition of the outermost layer of the cornea is through the aqueous. Nextly, it's the Bowman's membrane, which contains collagen fibers, and regeneration is not possible in this layer. And the thickest layer of the cornea is the stromal layer. It contains 78% water and 60% collagen fibers, and there is a particular uniform lattice arrangement of the collagen fibers, which help maintaining the transparent nature of the cornea. And the space between the collagen fibers and keratocytes is filled with ground substance made up of proteoglycans and glycosaminoglycans known as keratin sulfate and chondroitin sulfate. Next comes the Descemet's layer. It is possibly the strongest layer and is the last to be damaged in cases of injury or infection. And they have the ability to regenerate after injury. And the most important layer of the cornea is the endothelial cell layer, which is the innermost layer, and it is composed of a single layer of hexagonal cells, and the number of endothelial cells per cubic millimeter is 3000, And if a person loses 75% of these endothelial cells, the cornea doesn't remain transparent. It becomes opaque, because in the endothelial cell layer there are certain sodium potassium ATPase pump which pump out the excess water from the cells and help maintaining the corneal transparency. And the endothelium layer also lacks the ability to regenerate. The functions of the cornea I have already covered. So the next is the sclera. The sclera is the outer covering of the eye except in the area of the cornea. It provides a very strong structure to the eye and helps in protection and maintaining the shape of the eye. And it lies above the choroid and posteriorly is pierced by the optic nerve. The sclera is mainly composed of elastic fibers, collagen fibers, fibroblasts and blood vessels. The difference from the collagen fibers that are present in the cornea versus that the collagen fibers that is present in the sclera is that in the sclera the collagen fibers are not arranged regularly. So the cornea, sclera is not transparent like the cornea. Now the last layer is the middle layer is the vascular layer or the uvea, and it is composed of three structures: the choroid, the ciliary body and the iris. The choroid is located just beneath the sclera and lies above the retina. It's a dark blue, brown structure and it is highly vascularized. It provides the retina with the essential nutrients and oxygen. Not the entire retina, but the outer few layers of the retina are supplied by the choroid. The choroid prevents the scattered light from reaching the retina. So it limits the amount of light reaching the retina. Now next comes the ciliary body. The ciliary body is divided into two parts. Firstly, we have the ciliary processes, which are nothing but the finger-like projections. And they have secretory function because they secrete aqueous. And next is the ciliary muscle, which have mechanical function. So the ciliary process, as I have said, is responsible for secreting the aqueous humor to the anterior chamber to supply the lens and the cornea with nutrients since they are not vascularized. And aqueous humor contains glucose, amino acids and respiratory gases for diffusion. Now the ciliary body also contains the ciliary muscles, which are responsible for accommodation of the lens by contraction and relaxation, which changes the shape of the lens to either flat or spherical depending on the distance of the object. Next is the iris. The iris is located between the lens and the cornea and it divides the eyeball into anterior and posterior chambers. The iris has got two muscles, the sphincter pupillae muscle, which as the name suggests, contracts in response to bright light, so limiting the amount of light that enters the eye. And the dilator muscle actually dilate in response to dim light, allowing whatever light that is present in that dim room to enter the eye. Finally, the most important structure of the eye, the retina. The retina has got a very important structure called the macula, which is a area 3 to 5 millimeter and at the posterior pole of the eye, in the center of which lies the fovea, which is free of blood vessels and contain only cone cell. Now these are the 10 layers of the retina that you have to memorize. It is given in exams. The labeling of the diagram might be very small for you to understand. You please consult your book and practice this diagram. So these are the 10 layers of the retina. From outside in, they are the retinal pigment epithelium. And the following 9 layers are called as the neurosensory retina. First comes the lamina of rods and cones. Then is the external limiting membrane, outer nuclear layer, outer plexiform layer, inner nuclear layer, inner plexiform layer, ganglion cell layer, then the layer of nerve fibers, and finally the internal limiting membrane. This picture is more clear, the labeling is more clear in this picture. So first a few words about the retinal pigment epithelial layer. So they contain the word pigment means that they contain melanin containing epithelial cells between choroid and neural portion, and it's involved in the renewal of rods and cones, photoreceptor cells by phagocyting the old aging cells. And also the retinal pigment epithelial layer absorbs light and prevents the reflection and scattering of light. Now the neural portion includes all the other 9 layers of the retina. The 3 most important structures being the ganglion cell layer, the bipolar cell layer and the photoreceptor layer. So first, the ganglion cell layer is the final common pathway that the nerve impulse crosses since the dendrites reach the bipolar cells and axon extend to the CNS. So ganglion cell layer are essential, the axons of the ganglion cell layer are what makes up the optic nerve. The bipolar cell layer, each cell which with one or more dendrites extending to the cones and rods and horizontal cells and interplexiform cells, they communicate with the cone cell on one hand and with the ganglion cell on the other hand. So they form communicating cells between the ganglion cell layer and the rod and cone cells. Now finally the photoreceptor layer, the layer of rods and cones, and these structures you have to memorize, and it is given in exams. So we have to remember the number of rods that are present. So it is roughly 120 million rod and 6 million cone neurons present in both the eyes together. And we have to remember that rods are responsible for black and white vision, that is the vision in the dim light. And they are concentrated more at the peripheral retina and decreases in number as we go towards the center or the fovea, while the cones are responsible for scotopic vision, means vision in bright light. So they are more concentrated at the fovea. The photopigment that is present in both rods and cones is made up of a glycoprotein called opsin and the chromatophore forming cisretinal, which is a derivative of vitamin A. So that is why vitamin A deficiency causes night blindness, because rods are responsible for vision in night. Now a little bit about the physiology of vision, which shall also be covered in the subsequent classes. In short, we should know that there are two isomers present in the retinal photopigments. First is the cisretinal, which is the inactive form, and another is the transretinal, which is the active form. So at daytime, the cisretinal gets exposed to light, it gets activated and releases opsin and undergoes a structural change to transretinal form, which then leads to a cascade of events like inhibition of glutamate neurotransmitter release and causes the closure of sodium channels, causing hyperpolarization and initiation of a nerve impulse along the nerves. In physiology, we have learned that in order for a action potential to happen, the nerves actually depolarize. But in cases of optic nerve, there is a hyperpolarization during the initiation of a nerve impulse. And there is an enzyme called transducin, which activates another enzyme called phosphodiesterase, causing the closure of sodium channels. And when the sodium ions decrease inside the cell, the intracellular charge will decrease also, until it unleashes an action potential. And at night time, when the light is too low to activate the rhodopsin and release a nerve impulse, the glutamate neurotransmitter is highly secreted, which transports the impulse. Now coming to the interior of the eyeball, it can be divided into the anterior cavity and the posterior cavity. A little bit about the lens. A lens is located between the vitreous humor and the iris. The lens is about 9 to 10 millimeter in diameter and it is attached to the ciliary body via thin filaments called zonules, and the lens is non-vascularized and transparent, and the lens fibers are rich in a protein known as crystalline and actin. It has got two surfaces. It's a biconvex structure having two surfaces, the anterior surface which is less convex than the posterior, and it has got a radius of curvature of 10 mm, while the posterior surface has got a more curved configuration, the radius of curvature being 6, and the refractive index is 1.39 to 1.42, and the total dapteric power is 16 to 17 dapter, which can be said that it's approximately 20 dapter. So the eye as a whole has got a power of 60 dapter, of which I've already said 40 dapter is contributed by the cornea, and the rest, approximately 20 dapter, is contributed by the lens. And the lens has got an equatorial diameter of 6.5 mm at birth, which increases to 9 to 10 mm in adulthood and remains constant that way. The weight varies throughout the age, and when a person develops cataract, the weight of the lens increases because of excessive lens hydration. Now, this is another important anatomy diagram that you have to remember. First, the outermost layer is that of the lens capsule, the anterior capsule and the posterior capsule. And just beneath the anterior capsule, we can see a single layer of cells, single layer of epithelial cells, that is the anterior lens epithelial cell. And you please note that the layer of cells is absent posteriorly. That means that in a lens, only the anterior epithelial cells are present, and there is no posterior epithelial cells because they are used up during the development of the nucleus when the child is in utero. Lastly, there is the vitreous humor. So it's an inner transparent colorless jelly-like structure that provides a clear optical media as well as a pathway of nutrients which is to be utilized by the lens, ciliary body and retina. And it is also clear and avascular, filling the space bounded by anteriorly by the lens and posteriorly by retina and the optic disc, and it occupies approximately 80% of the volume of the globe. Apart from having the optical refractive function, it has also got a role in supporting the structure of the eyeball. So the vitreous gel consists of a delicate meshwork of type 2 collagen fibrils, and it can be divided anatomically into the anterior layer or membrane, which is the most anterior portion, the cortical vitreous, which is present in the periphery near the retina, and medullary vitreous, which lies in between. In the physiochemical properties, the volume of the vitreous is 4 ml and the weight is 4 gram. It is easy to remember. The pH is 7.2 and it is composed of 99% water. The refractive index is same as that of aqueous, which is also 1.336. And the osmotic pressure is 5 to 8 milliosmol per liter. And it's a fairly viscous structure, its viscosity being 1.030 to 1.045. The last slide of the presentation, the ocular blood supply is given by the ophthalmic artery, which is a branch of the carotid artery. So in the eye, the ophthalmic artery has got three branches. First of all, the central retinal artery, which supplies the retina, while the posterior ciliary arteries, which enter the eyeball through the posterior aspect and supplies the the choroid, there also some anterior portion of the optic nerve, and finally the iris and the ciliary body, while all the extraocular muscles are supplied by the muscular arteries. Thank you.